Round 2 of the season is over, and the question is, what did we learn from the Grand Prix? Other than, well, the Red Bull is a complete rocket ship in a straight line. Well, there's actually a lot of interesting points that we learned from the Grand Prix, and a lot of interesting data to analyse, and that is exactly what we're going to be doing today, as we take a look and analyse the data from the Saudi Arabian Grand Prix. If you enjoyed the video, please hit the like button and subscribe for more F1 content. Currently, the majority of viewers are not currently subscribed, and if you're one of those, I would greatly appreciate it if you just tap that little sub button. Now, let's get to the video. Just before I start, I just want to say that I will be getting to Ferrari, Mercedes, Aston Martin, and Red Bull a little bit later on, so stick around for that. And before we look at any of the teams, I just want to take a quick look at the tyres for this race. Pirelli opted to take the C2, C3 and C4 tyres, which is a step softer than Bahrain. However, there is a lot less pit stops than in the Bahrain Grand Prix, as most drivers opted to do the one-stop strategy, as I kind of expected. Most drivers did the medium and hard tyre strategy, with only Leclerc opting to do the soft to hard tyres for Ferrari. Later on in the video, I will be talking about why I think it was actually smart for Ferrari to go and do this with starting on the softs, but why they made a mistake when it came to the strategy for Charles. The hard compound tyre was not a very fast tyre, but it was incredibly durable, as Piastri was able to run the hard tyres from lap 1 all the way until the end of the race, with very little drop off in performance. Speaking of Piastri, we are now going to be taking a look at the teams towards the back of the field, and we're going to start with the McLaren and the Williams teams, and for long-standing F1 fans, you might want to look away. The two teams that dominated the 80s and 90s of F1 are right now two of the teams that are the slowest cars. Although for McLaren, it's not easy to say with any certainty where they are. In qualifying, they have a really good car that can get them into Q3. Oscar Piastri managed this with the slowest car in a straight line, but when it comes to race pace, they're just not really there. The McLarens finishing towards the back was kind of expected. I did mention this after my quali video that McLaren were very slow in a straight line, meaning that it would have been incredibly difficult for them to maintain position, and we saw this slow speed during the Grand Prix. Towards the back end of the race, we saw Logan Sargeant struggling on medium tyres, but he was able to hold on to position from the two McLaren cars that were behind him, despite the fact that McLarens were faster cars overall. And how can we tell this? Well, I've pulled up the lap times from Sargeant, Norris and Piastri. The two McLaren cars caught Sargeant and De Vries on lap 38, and you can see that from lap 32 onwards, the McLaren start to become the faster car as Sargeant is battling with De Vries and his medium tyres are starting to lose their best performance. But when they catch Sargeant on lap 38, they pretty much stall and become very similarly paced with Sargeant as they can't find a way by. For McLaren, this is a real problem that they will need to sort out, and just to illustrate how slow they are, here is the same graph from qualifying, and it shows clearly that the slowest car in a straight line by some distance is that McLaren car. If they don't fix the issue with drag that they have, then they're going to spend all year towards the back of the field, because you cannot overtake cars when your car is 6 or 7 kilometers per hour slower than the next slowest car. For AlphaTauri and Haas, they both had an improved race from Bahrain. AlphaTauri, for the second race in a row, were just out of the points with Yuki Tsunoda. Both races now, Tsunoda has been within 3 seconds of scoring points. Last time he lost out to Williams, and this time Tsunoda was in the points all the way up until lap 46 when he was overtaken by the Haas of Kevin Magnussen. For K-Mag and Haas, they fared much better than they did in Bahrain. In round 1, they really did not have good race pace as both drivers sunk like a stone. But in Saudi Arabia, they were able to finish in 10th and 12th. Both drivers opted to take an early pit stop and get off of the medium tyres and onto the hard tyres. The safety car came out on lap 18, but K-Mag stopped on lap 8 and Hülkenberg stopped on lap 11. This was a very good call by Haas. With them opting to stop early, they got out of any traffic and were running in free, clear air. and this helped them to get up the field as opposed to being a bit further down the field. These early stops once again goes to show just how durable the hard tyre was this weekend. The question is though, has Haas sorted out their tyre wear issue from Bahrain, or is this just a one-off due to how durable the hard tyres were this weekend? Only time will tell, sadly. It does seem a little bit too early to say, but I hope this is the start of something good for the Haas team, because when the car is working, it is a decent race car. Qualifying in Bahrain showed that they can have a fast car, and in Saudi they had one car start in the top 10. Not only this, but their race pace was actually pretty similar to the Alpines, and to show this, I have brought up Gasly and Magnussen. The graph essentially shows us that Haas on race pace is within a couple of tenths of a second of Alpine right now. As for AlphaTauri, hopefully it is now just a matter of time before they can score their first points of the season. Now though, what about Aston Martin, Ferrari, Mercedes and the Red Bull teams? Well, let's start with what is probably the most interesting aspect from the Grand Prix, and that is in race trim, Mercedes was faster than Ferrari when they got onto the hard compound tyres. For two races in a row now, it seems like Ferrari has really struggled when they bolt on the hardest possible compound. I'm just going to show this graph from Bahrain, and what it shows is when they put the hard compound tyres on, Ferrari went from being the second fastest car to the fourth fastest car, and it seems like that was a similar case in Saudi as well. Ferrari, it seems, has a great car when it comes to qualifying, however in race trim, they do seem to be struggling on the harder tyres. Charles' pace on the soft tyres was really impressive. In fact, it was faster than Sainz's pace on the medium compound was, as this graph shows. Even though Leclerc was coming through traffic, Leclerc was still faster on those soft tyres versus Carlos Sainz on the mediums. When Sainz stopped to get off those medium tyres, Leclerc was still even at that point going faster on the softs. That tells me that Ferrari really could have, and probably should have, kept both drivers out on circuit instead of pitting when they did. This brings me back to what I said earlier. Ferrari did get it right with Charles starting on soft, however I think they missed the trick by keeping Leclerc out and extending as he was still finding time. What they could have done is attempted a soft medium strategy for Leclerc. Leclerc has been better on his tyres than Sainz has for the first two races, and arguably has been a faster driver as well. So it would have been worth the risk with Leclerc, I think. Had they done this, he probably would have beaten Sainz, Hamilton, and just maybe George Russell, although of course that is not exactly guaranteed. For Mercedes, they had a great race overall. Qualifying was not strong for them, and Hamilton did struggle at the start of the race as he started on the hard compound tyres, but Russell had great pace all race long and was faster than teammate Lewis Hamilton. Hamilton was essentially saved by the safety car, as it seemed that before then, Hamilton was in for a long race full of pain and misery. He was passed quickly by Leclerc and Verstappen, and generally, he was stuck racing the Alpines. But when the safety car came out, his race came alive in a way. He was able to get off of the hard tyres that he was really struggling with, and then changed onto the medium tyres and managed to jump Leclerc. Lewis then pulled off a brilliant move to pass Carlos Sainz and was all over his teammate Russell. That was, of course, until the closing stages of the race, when I imagine his mediums did start to wear out a little bit. And he started to drop off from Russell, who was trying to stay within 5 seconds of Alonso in case, of course, of Alonso's penalty. Speaking of Alonso, let's get to Aston Martin. Once again, Aston Martin were the best of the rest, and I am fully convinced now that the biggest threat to Red Bull is not Ferrari or Mercedes, but instead it is Aston Martin, especially with all the wind tunnel time that they have between now and July to try and close that gap. Once again in qualifying, Alonso was behind a Ferrari. But sadly for that Ferrari driver, they had a big grid penalty, meaning that Alonso was on the front row alongside Perez. Alonso did get the best start and he did get past Perez and actually held him off for longer than I thought he would. But eventually Perez did blow past and take the lead, and from there it was pretty easy going for Red Bull. And well, Red Bull, it seems, is managing a massive pace advantage. How can we tell that exactly? Well, firstly, let's take a look at the top speed that Red Bull had versus their rivals. As this graph shows, Max Verstappen had a top speed of 343 kilometers per hour. This would be, of course, with slipstream and DRS, and probably using ERS as well. But where are the real rivals? Leclerc hit a top speed of 337 kph, and Perez hit 334 kph. But remember, that would have been early on in the race when fat with fuel. Hamilton hit 328 kilometers per hour, and Alonso only hit 323 kilometers per hour, and Russell didn't even reach 320 kph. Which is approximately 200 miles per hour. In terms of fastest laps, Max Verstappen produced the fastest lap on the final lap of the race, which was about 1 second faster than the pace had been that they were essentially cruising at. This tells me that Red Bull has a lot of pace hidden in the locker that they can and probably will unleash when they need to. We saw this in qualifying as well, when they had a huge straight line speed advantage. It will be interesting to see if this carries forward for the rest of the season, but surely that straight line speed was a wake-up call for their rivals. So what did we learn from this Grand Prix? Aston Martin is officially the second fastest car overall in the sport. Ferrari has a great qualifying car, but they are lacking when it comes to race pace and are struggling on the harder compound of tyres. Mercedes seems to have an alright race car, but they are lacking some overall pace. And Red Bull is just on another planet. Their efficiency is unmatched. It is by far the fastest car out there. So, I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, as always, comment, leave a like, and subscribe for more F1 content. Thank you all so much for watching.